Okay, so I will start my last lecture. So today I will talk about the recent work of Shou-Wu Yun and Yun-Zhang about their so-called high Gorzaga formula of a function field. And as the last time, I tried to explain that the Chola-Seber formula should be considered as a kind of special case of Gorzaga formula. The special case not mean that the theorem itself, the proof itself. So because when you prove Gorzaga formula, you prove one generating theorist equals another generating theorist. And in a very degenerate case, that identity will imply Chola-Seber formula. And then at the end of lecture, Emmanuel asked the question, why Gorzaga formula is true. At the very beginning, in the 80s, we believed that Gorzaga is true because of BSD is true. People believe in BSD. But if you're looking for the Chola-Seber formula, it's a different story. Chola-Seber formula is about a second term. It's not about the first term. BSD is always about the first term. So that's already giving indication. The Gorzaga formula probably nothing to do with the first term. Right? It's simply an expression of tail expansion. So that's actually, you will see my today's lecture, you see this is pretty clear that you're supposed to have a formula to explain every derivative. So the work of the Shou-Wu Yun and Yun-Zhang has a significance in two directions. First of all, he proved all the different derivatives. The second thing, they introduced a new method called a relative trace formula. So in the classical proof of the Gorzaga formula, we use a Weyl representation. Weyl representation is not as powerful as a trace formula, but it's more effective. Once it works, everything is precise. Trace formula, you have to do a lot of analysis. But once it works for general group. So the method I explained today should be the future method for the number theory, more than the Weyl representation. But of course, Shou-Wu Yun and Yun-Zhang, they work on the function field. So they have a new technique they can use, is left-shift trace formula. So in fact, they prove all the identity by prove identity between the perverse sheaf. So that's a new technique. It does not work with a number field case. So that's why in assumption, they assume everything is unramified, because they want to make sure that the modular stack of Shtukas is a smooth Shtukas of FQ. OK, so we start with some notation. So I start with F of FQ, a curve, smooth, geometrically connected. And so let's start, we take a cover, X of Y, this is the cover, and we assume unramified. Of course, the theorem it still makes sense once it's ramified. So I checked the way last week, and here in the Shou-Wu Yun already pushed everything to square-free conduct. But they said they need some time to finish the manuscript. So we're not going to talk about the new result. Still an unramified double cover. So we have g of y equals 2 g of x minus 1, right? So you have this identity. So in particular, g of x cannot be 0, right? Because, I assume y is connected. So I have a standard notation is fq of x e fq of y. Then I use ideals. It's ideals of f. So it's a restriction product of of v, the places. I mean, in function field case, it means the closer point. Oh, this is the weight. So V is inside. Okay. And I write this in. This is just the, maybe let me write. I don't like this. It's a letter, a bit strange. O of A, it just induce O X, X inside X. And I write the eta is a the quadratic character of A F cross, A F cross plus minus 1 is a quadratic character associated to extension E of F. So that's a pretty much standard notation of average AK, you know. Some other people don't use this notation. So there, then you have error function. This error function, it's a pretty standard error function. Eta of A, the devices. So A is ideas or whatever, or devices or whatever. It's an effective divisor. Idea. So this you can write them pretty clearly. Zeta function of Y, zeta function of X. So if you're using Lefschetz stress formula, you will get Verbinis of Q negative S over V. So this V is H1 Y H1 Y of QL H1 X of QL. So so this is the same. So this is the dimension of V is 2G minus 1. So you see that this error function is actually a polynomial, right, in Q of negative S. So it's a pretty simple object. So question we want to understand, so what is the derivative? What is the tail expansion? Of error eta S in S minus 1. So I mean that the error, R is the derivative of eta at 1, right? I mean that if the functional equation may be easier, it's 0, okay? That's easy, okay? That's something we're gonna do. This is a pretty interesting question. So they have two different formulas. So the first two cases, an example is R eta 0. This is just special value. That's a class number formula. The cardinality of Jacobian of Y of FQ, Jacobian X of FQ. So this is a class number formula. Right, so then of course, error prime eta of 0 should be something called Shou-Wu type of formula. Right, in this case, probably can do exactly the same way as we do in the classic Shou-Wu type of formula. I'm not really sure. Because we don't have dedicated eta function. I'm not even sure how to prove this, right? Without using the Kurosawa formula. Because in the classical case of the modular curve, we use dedicated eta function to compute it. So even in this case, we do not know what's going on. Okay, so this is a question we want to answer. And as I said last time, that is, this everything should be the special case of higher Gross-Zagier formula. So this higher Gross-Zagier formula somehow relies on construction of some modular space over a base dimension R. That's a new concept introduced in their paper. So the classical arithmetic is a variety of a number field, a variety of function field of a curve. So they introduce new arithmetic. So arithmetic, say if the base is one dimensional, you will not do much. It just only takes the first derivative. If you want R's derivative, you need to introduce more. You need to have a base high dimension. So that's a very interesting phenomenon. So from now on, we assume that. So now assume, let's go back to new thing. So I start with, this is the question I want to do. So we assume that R is even. So we introduce the Shtukas, the kind of definition that so let R S be a scheme, XR scheme. So really means S is a scheme of Q with a morphism from XS to XR, right? I from 1 to R. Then, so a GRN, Shtukas, an S is a diagram. Is a diagram of morphisms, right? On bundles and on X cross S. So what I really mean, so you have this Redis notation will be have inclusion. This is actually not isomorphic. R over 2, then change the direction. Okay? And the last one, you want isomorphic to their 0 to the sigma. So I'll explain these notations. The notation is the following. So this xi are bundles would have x cross s, rank n bundles, and the subquotients I of I minus 1 or I of I plus 1 depends if I is less than r over 2, bigger than r over 2. So these are align bundles. So when this I less equal than r over 2, I bigger than r over 2. So this is isomorphic to gamma xi of Li. Gamma xi, this is the graph of xi. So the gamma xi is S map to S cross X. Okay, start here. Li are line bundles on S. So this is the first thing. The second thing, the zero sigma is a product by Frobenius. One times Frobenius S pull back of x0. So remember, there's x cross S there. I take a Frobenius of this direction, but not this direction. Okay, I've been over FQ, for example. So it's not it's a take a Q's power, not their. So this is called a Shtukas. Why this thing is interesting, of course, is the morphism. phi from Shtukas is a morphism of diagram. Cartesian morphism. Diagram. So we're not going to describe. So the interesting thing about this Shtukas, I give you two examples, show you why this is an interesting object. So example, if r equals 0, so I don't have any modification. What?
Cartesian,
yeah.
So in this case, what do you mean?
It just means that there's a, probably I don't really need a Cartesian. No, don't need. If I have a modification, yeah, probably I don't even need it.
In Dawson's inequality, just in front of you, the second quality is also non-strict.
Right.
Non-strict, if you brought it strict.
Say it again?
No, you have just EI over EI plus 1. I think it started from R over 2 again.
Yes.
Started with R
over 2.
R over 2. Oh, okay. Start R over 2. And that's, so this is less than. Oh my, okay, so this one has a two bundle with index of I. Okay, that's a, that makes sense, you know, so I cannot have. Okay, so R equals 0, Cartesian product.
I'm sorry, I'm lost in the ranks of the bundles. So you said
rank
that
one.
Line bundles. These are line bundles. What? EI is a vector bundle of X cross S.
Yeah, but which rank?
Rank N. All of them same rank. Yeah, all of them are GRN bundles. Yeah. So R equals 0 is a very interesting case because they don't have all this in here. It's just the last step. The last step gives you a data of descent, right? So this means nothing. It just means, so we have this bundle. So we have this Shtukas of R equals 0 of N. It's essentially the classical automorphic space, GRN of F, GRN of A, of GRN of O of A. Right, it's just a points scheme of FQ. And R equals 1, and no, R equals 1 doesn't make sense, R equals even. So let's take a case. When n equals 1, right? So we call the line bundles. You have line bundles, I mean, there's always a line bundles one to other. So the difference, the morphism between line bundles is it determined by devices. So basically, it starts with the first bundle. And all these devices, it's determined by this graph, gamma xi. So it's also one equation. You don't get many equations. So in fact, I'm not going to write down all the details. So roughly speaking, if n equals 1, your bundle of 1R is fitting in a Cartesian picture, pick of x goes to pick of x 0. This goes to x to the R mapped here. So you have a Cartesian product. And here, this morphism is given by xi goes to ox summation xi I less equal than r over 2 minus summation xi I bigger than r over 2. Let me see. Yeah, I mean I from 0 from 1 to r over 2. Yes, I from, because the x I equals 0. Yes, yes.
What does it mean from pk to pk 0, yeah?
What? It's not the vertical one?
From here to here, you start with the line bundle, goes to line bundle sigma minus 1. You take the conjugate, then the Frobenius, then the minus 1. So this is the Cartesian thing. So the kernel of this morphism from here is nothing else. It's a Picard X of FQ points.
Is it really made from peak or from peak 0 to peak?
From peak.
Peak
reserve degree? Or? Because the peak is actually the E0. It's just some line bundle. You don't care which line bundle. You don't have a degree thing. So this gives you an idea that the SH1R is a principal homogeneous space over XR for the group of a pick X of FQ. Right. So this is already a very interesting object. So this gives you a geometric construction of our eta cover of XR for arbitrary R.
It's kind of
right. What?
It's kind of
Artin-Schreier. Yes. To give you a covering. So that's already tell you, even over for n equals 1, it's an interesting object. So we will restrict it. We will restrict everything to the case R equals 2. So now assume now R equals 2. Oh no, R no, n equals 2. Right? So there, n equals 1 is pretty clear. In this case, we will introduce the Heck operator. So for any D effective divisor on X, we define that the Heck operator. We define the Heck operator let me see how can I do. I can do two things. Yeah, I can define a Heck operator of R H of D. So H of D is a Heck operator. So this Heck operator is a stack, Heck stack, yeah. And the fitting in is a correspondence. Let me fit in some picture here. So you have so it's the correspondence. You have this. so what's the notation I do? 2 H of D goes to 2 R. And 2R, then for the morphism of X of R. So there, this is equal to all the objects phi from 2 prime, such that the determinant divisor of determinant phi is D. So as I said, that if you have a morphism between two Shtukas, then you have a morphism between these vector bundles, because the Cartesian property I just put there, the determinant doesn't depend which vector bundle you choose. So you have the same quotient.
But you did not explain what is this Cartesian property. Could you explain?
Maybe this is the definition, you know. So I just want to have these line bundles. Probably, do I need this thing?
But just explain it for n equal 2 so we can see.
Let me try to see. I just want to, yeah. Okay, so it doesn't really. This probably is the definition. I wrote it because just. No, it just means the commutative diagram. One, no, forget about Cartesian, just commutative diagram. Okay. Yeah, because it's nothing, you don't really need any Cartesian, just commutative diagram. The point is that I already know that the modification is rank one, so I worry about that part. If I don't have this restriction at this rank one thing, I worry about it. So this is phi I, right? So phi. What?
Coming to diagram, the last map and the first map are conjugated by Frobenius.
Right. Yeah, so all these things, you map everything, this diagram to next diagram, make everything be committed to you.
Yeah, but the last one and the first one.
First one is the same. It's the same morphism, yeah. So this is, you get these hack operators, that's usual. And for our study today, we actually want to quote it by another thing. So we will, we only work on a GLPGL2. So we only study the SHTG of R to be HH2R mod pick of XFQ. So the point is the following. So this is a diagram, and the only non-trivial thing, the last part you have a Frobenius. So if I start with a vector bundle already defined of FQ, you can tensor this diagram by these line bundles. Nothing will change. So then I also quoted by HG of H of D is a similar thing to R H of D quoted by the image of that. Okay? That's you can say that I don't know what the quote means. Because all the morphism between the bundles, when you quote it by a line bundle, still have a morphism. So this probably means that. So anyway, so if this is the case, this becomes there's a involution on this and this thing. So if you like an elliptic curve, you have a E1 map to E2, you have a conjugate map. Without if it don't work on a PGL2, you will not. You will have a, when you come back, you have to modify by something, right? So when you cannot really give a morphism, you cannot define a dual morphism easily. So when the PGL2, that's the case you are doing. Okay, so this is some easy thing about a Shtukas. And of course, the major theorem in the about Shtukas is the following. So we don't say anything. So the theorem, so this is for Drumfeld, when R equals 2, and Bashovsky for general R, is that, so this this Shtukas N R is a Dillon Manifold Shtukas and a stack, and which is locally finite of FQ. So in fact, it has a countably many. It has as a filtration by because it's a vector bundles, you can attach a stability to the vector bundles, right? In this way, using stability, you can make a covering by schemes of finite type. But now, unlike the typical vector bundles over a curve, the boundary is very small, so this boundary can go forever. So there's no, the boundary still is high, very big. So it's not finite type, it's infinite type. The second thing, so the morphism between T and R to X of R is cannot be proper. It's a smooth of dimension relative dimension equal to r equal n minus 1. Just a moment, I don't know which one. R equals n minus 1. So the interesting case we want to start is n equals 2. If n equals 2, for example, then you will get this of r, x of r. So this is the dimension r, this is the relative dimension r. So it's itself a dimension 2r of fq. So this is the dimension itself, 2r, the dimension equals r. So this gives you a hint. You can define the intersection theory on this thing. And
you don't mention Lafort in this statement, so it's
nothing to do with Lafort.
You know Lafort? So
no. For this one.
For this statement, no.
No.
Even the smoothness.
What?
Even the smoothness.
Yeah, this is Warshawski theorem. Yeah. I mean, Lafort probably for n is big. No. This is purely Warshawski theorem. Okay, so, and for people who care about Langlands program, and what we care about the Gonzaga formula, there are two different difference. People who care about Langlands program only care about generic fiber. So, when XR, you have a generic fiber there. We actually care about whole scheme, whole stack of FQ. So there is a difference. And this difference actually caused a lot of trouble. So somehow you have this Langlands program for generic fiber, for example, you know how to call homology decompose, right? But in the study, this Gonzaga formula, we actually want to study and understand the cohomology whole scheme, whole stack of FQ. That's actually the major difficulty in the study of this problem. So in other words, we care about integral model, not necessarily just the generic fiber. Okay, so this is the basic concepts about Shtukas. So the next thing I want to do, I want to talk about CM Shtukas. Or in their terminology, they call CM, they call it the Drumfeld Hingness. Shtukas. And a geometric kernel. So the first few lectures, I will talk about three different kernels. One is geometric kernel, one is analytic kernel, the last one is the Lefschetz kernel. So the theorem is proved by all these three kernels are equal to each other. Right? So that's the thing. So the first one I talk about the Drumfeld Hingner, Shtukas. So that's the easy thing to see. So we have this y mapped to x by nu. So this will give you a morphism between the stack, the rank one stack of R, but it's for Y to rank two stack. And X, I put X here of R just by push forward. So if you have a line bundles here, you just take the push forward line bundle, you get a vector bundle of rank 2. So that's like a typical situation. And of course, this one is over y of r, this is over x of r. Right? So you get this thing. And then you can quote it by pick x of fq and all the picture. But it's just everything quoted by thing here. So you will get SHT RY to SHT of G of R. So this is a T. This is a GR1. It's by GR1 Y divided by, the restriction scale. Y of X of GR1. Right? You get this thing. So, but not only get this thing, because you get another morphism here. So you can put everything in the one picture. X to the R, Y to the R. So you get this morphism, right? And then we define the notation here. It's too complicated. This is a major thing I'm going to study, the two morphisms. So the both them. So now both them is over YR. So this is relative dimension equals zero. The relative dimension is R, right? So let me rewrite the picture here. So okay, so I write this thing equals Z, right? This thing is called M. So I get Z mapped M goes to YR. I get this diagram. Right. So this is a stack of dimension 2R. This is a stack of dimension R. This is R. So in fact, this one is a compact stack because the relative dimension is 0.
I don't understand why you have this T. So the first one is over Y, isn't it?
Yes.
OK, so over Y you have, the group should be over Y also.
Yeah, GR1 of Y.
Yeah, so in some sense, what I would get there is just Y to the R. I don't see why I got this restriction of scalars. For me, I will get, by the description you gave for N equal 1,
X,
yeah. Yeah, I will get just y to the r. The first, this z for me should be y to the r. I don't understand why.
Why? Say it again. This is
z. Yeah. Z for me should be y to the r.
No, this is this diagram.
Yes. So, but you have to take the quotient by the peak.
But by peak of y, I call it by peak of x. Okay, so this is the principal homogeneous space of peak of Y.
Yeah. Okay.
So this is a Galois cover with this group. Okay.
Okay, because then you cannot quote by peak of Y. Okay.
Yeah. Right. Okay, so this is z. So z is a trim field thing in a cycle. Right. When I compute it, and as I said, z is actually the compact because of this thing. So this z. Define a class inside, I don't know, maybe write define some notation. I'm going to remember theta here. So you have a theta. Theta star of this thing is inside CH, the char group with the compact support of this coordination R of M. So that's a good thing. It's a compact. And that's the one reason, I guess, they study the case when y mapped to x is not split. And presumably, say, why? Maybe I can take a y to be two copies of x. So I get a two line bundles take direct sum, for example. Right? So I consider all the Shtukas, which is a sum of two line bundles. Right? So that's a perfect subspace. But if you do that Shtuka, that space will be. It's still compact, right? I don't know what's going on. So why I ask them question, why do they just pick computer even more trivial case? Why is there two copies of X? They say there's some problem with compactifications. Okay, so we're not going to describe their thing. So in particular, we can define the self-intersection. So z here, so I just briefly, this really means that the whole thing this one. And if you want to make connection to the fault in the height, so this is actually equal to C of R of the relative bundle of M over YR of Z, right? So you can define this way. So this looks like the fault in the height. So the main theorem, which is related to the fault in height, is what we maybe I should call the high Chola Seba formula. By this Yun-Zhang Nami, probably last year. So one of the very surprising theorem is that they give us the formula for the derivatives of our functions. So prove that, so this z equal to 2 to the r plus 2 divided by log of q to the r to the power l of r at of 0. And this r is even, but it's enough because this function does not have, has the order coefficient. Is that right or not? Okay, so this is the maxim that proved we are interested. As I said, that I mean this Chola-Seba formula is always a special case Kurosaki formula. So let's say what's the Kurosaki formula want to do. So for high,
do you have some information on z gamma z? Do you know the sign of z gamma z?
Sign of. Oh, this is a positive. Because by Riemann hypothesis, by GRH. But there's a theorem in function of your case. So you take a tail expansion and this side of zero. It's a holomorphic function there, so there's nothing. Yeah, so it's always positive. Yeah, for high Kurosaki, we can explain. So we need to need the formula for not only the thing there for z h d. Of z. So this d, the hd is a head corporate. So roughly speaking, that's a picture here. You have a Hecker correspondence. You have a cycle here. You pull back to this one, then push forward. Right? So that's the cycle you get. So that's by Hecker correspondence there. So in fact, that's the way. So in fact, even for the proof of this high Chola-Seba formula, you cannot prove directly. You have to prove the high Kurosaki first. So the strategy proof is the following. So I give a strategy of the proof. So strategy so they have two ingredients. So maybe I call it ingredient. Not a strategy. So first thing they computed. The first ingredient is that this intersection numbers. This z of h d z can be computed in the cohomology group. So that's a very different thing than number theory. N is a V, HC of 2R of M of Q bar, right? So the QL of R, so L is a prime, not equal P. So that's the, so you compute actually in the cohomology group.
Just by the cycle class?
Cycle class, yeah. So that's something not like number theory, not like in number field case. We don't have such a, in number field case, presumably this is something called a Selmer group, whatever. But still have, we have this coefficient. So I don't know how to compute our Kirchhoff intersection theory purely using cohomology. But in function field case, you can do that. That's a good, that's an advantage.
In the very beginning of your talk, you introduce V is in proportion to first cohomology
yes,
of double power.
It's not the same.
It's not the same V. Yeah.
Oh, but yeah, not same V. That V is easier. Yes, that V is easier. Yeah, so that V, the question of two homology. This is it's a great thing. So one major. A major part of the paper is to study a structure of V and the Heck algebra. This is QL bar, QL whatever, joined with all these Heck operators. Is the effective divisor. Okay? So the main theorem they prove is the following. So the main result is that they got for this thing is this V equals V is Eisenstein part, direct sum of V, a cuspid part. We call it a cuspid part. I mean, presumably, I mean, the best thing you want to do, for example, we can show, say, this V is modular, like the usual one we do for the Lagrange program, or modularity, Taniyama-Shimura type conjecture. You want this to be modular, but unfortunately, they could not prove it. They cannot prove this one is a modular under the Heck algebra, but they proved not far away from Heck algebra, is that it's a direct, they have decomposition by Eisenstein part. And another part, a cuspid part, and this V0 is a finite dimensional. So this is a
of
QL. So this actually is a very nice thing. So even I don't know, it's a modular, but it's not a very big space. Right? I mean this is modular, Eisenstein, we're not gonna explain. So this is infinite dimensional. So the larger part of it, this sense, even dimensional, that's a finite dimensional. But don't be surprised why this finite dimensional. For example, this looks like I want to study like P1, right? P1 of Z, right? Like P1 of a curve, right? The cohomology should be finite dimensional. But this Eisenstein part is infinite dimensional, as I say, because of stability. You gross by stability a lot, but even this whole stack is not a finite type. So everything added is Eisenstein. You will not add too much. There's a cuspid part. Cuspid part is the center, right? If it defines stable locus, yes.
Is intersection trivial on self-intersection of Eisenstein part? Not trivial.
Yeah, but I said there's stability condition, the strata, each time introduce Eisenstein. Thing, but not the cuspid part is the center. So you don't really worry that much. So at the very beginning, this modular stack is scaring because it's not finite type. When you study the cohomology, you find that the most interesting part actually is the first stable locus. All other things, you just introduce some Eisenstein theories there. So that's the good news. Okay, so the second thing is a consequence of the first one. The second thing, so this above decomposition allow you to allows us to translate the computation z from z h of d, but degree of d sufficiently big, right? So you can compute this in, right? So you don't need to compute that d equals 0. D equals 0 is something we care about the Chola-Sieber formula. But here I say, well, actually don't care about d equals 0. Suppose you compute any big d. You compute enough. Because it's finite dimensional, you compute a few, some big d, then you're done. And for big d, somehow, we know how to compute it. But small d, we don't know how to compute it. Because this is because we want to translate everything to perverse shift, then translate everything to the module, to algebraic geometry. You have defined some modular space. This modular space somehow for d is bigger, has a better property when d is small. So that's another thing. Which will be the main point, main effort of computation. So this another thing is important is that, so this decomposition, actually the action of Heck algebra and H phi zero is almost semi-simple. So at least I can write down this thing. So this if I define I of D, defined to be the Z, H D star of Z, if I define this number, then I can have a decomposition. I can have a decomposition Z will have a summation of Z of pi plus Z of Eisenstein, for example, right? You can decompose the pi is the cuspidal representations. So maybe I write down, we're not going to write the Eisenstein separately, the pretended sum, including continuous spectrum. So this is pi, the irreducible representation of G, the spherical. You have such a formal sum. Once the formal sum, you can compute the geometric kernel. So there's something the geometric kernel want to do. So the geometric kernel will be, so we know that HD of Z pi is given by the lambda pi of H of D Z pi. So this lambda pi H of D, it's a Sataki parameter. So in other words, it's just the coefficient of the error function for pi, right? You remember, right, there's like elliptic curve, 1 minus AP, that's AP part, something like that. The coefficient of the Dirac error series. So this gives you that decomposition I of D equal to summation of pi lambda pi H of D of Z pi Z pi. So this gives you a very nice formula to decompose your geometric kernel as, so this geometric kernel is just a linear combination of this more primitive one with a coefficient. This is very important because eventually I will change my HD. When I change my HD, my coefficient changed, right? So this thing, so in other words, I mean, if I take all HD together, so ID for all H of D, so this space, so roughly speaking, this gives you a concrete idea about this number ID, and then this number Z pi, Z pi. So if I know everything but ID, then I can say something about I, Z pi, Z pi. So this is actually the gross Zagier thing I want to do. Okay, so this is about the geometric kernel. So now, next thing I want to talk about it. Do you want to take 5 minutes break? Okay, that is a 5 minutes break, then I can have two more sections to go. Okay, so I want to talk about I just introduced the geometric kernel. As I say, I introduced the three kernels. So they prove all three kernels equal to each other. So that's the way to prove. The second one is a more analysis, zeta integrals. And, zeta integrals and an analytical kernel. So it's just like a proof of gross Zagier. You have a geometric theorist, you are trying to show it is analytic. This is pretty similar. So we start with G equals GR, PGR2. And so we start with the Heck operator. So it's a smooth function with compact support, or G of A. And then from this one, you can define the K. Fxy is an automorphic function with two variables in a very simple way to define. And their gamma g of q, g of f. So this is an automorphic function with two variables. And the kernel represent the regular action of action of Heck algebra on L2 G of A G of F. Okay, so what I really mean, I mean that if you have a phi inside L2 space G of A G of F, then you can define the Heck operator as usual, G of A, 5x, y of f of y, dy, just write the translation. And you can rewrite this, and this is the definition. But if you're trying to put a gamma in the middle out of them that take their called a Fourier integral, it's easy to find that this is equal to the inner product between this phi of x kf y x and y dy, but this time is g of a, g of f, right? So this is represents that, but okay, of course, I mean, I didn't really talk about, probably it's better to say the conjugates, right? A complex conjugates, if we think about L2 product. So let's pretend that, forget about the detail of the complex conjugate, because I don't really use them that much. And so we have, so this implies that, we have a spectral decomposition so at least a formal one that k fxy summation of phi, so it is also normal basis, also normal basis of phi rho f of phi of x times phi bar of y, right? Just a formally. The formally, because first of all, it's not may not be convergent. You have you may have Eisenstein series, right? Yeah, it's not really some. So just give you idea. You have such a decomposition. Okay, so this is the this is usually called automorphic kernel. And in fact, in the theory of automorphic forms, that's only the automorphic function can be constructed easily, right? We don't know how to construct other functions. This is probably the cheapest way to construct automorphic forms, right? Because you give any f, you construct it. And an interesting thing that this actually include all the automorphic functions. The reason this is a head corporate. So, I mean, every automorphic forms basically appears in such a f. So when you change your f, you actually get all the information you want. So now we introduce the zeta integral. So this zeta integral actually need to be regularized. So we're not going to talk about them of JFS to be the integration of, okay, write A here, A is a diagonal in PGR2. So it's isomorphic to GR1. So I introduce the double integral, write A here cross A. So in automorphic form theory, this A is always means A of F, A of F. Right? So you have KF, X and Y, and XY of S, eta Y of DXY. So both X and Y are diagonal elements. The integration is takes X to the power. That's pretty familiar. Then I twist the second one by eta. So there's no much reason. You can twist by anything else, but that twist by eta, I have my own reason to do that. So this is it's a kind of a gigantic thing. But if I use the spectral decomposition there, then tell you immediately what I'm doing there. In terms of spectral decomposition, we know what do we have. We get JF of S. Just bring everything there. We will get summation of phi of integration of A rho F of phi of X and X of S dx times of A of phi bar of y to the s eta of y dy. So these two are typical the Heck error functions, right? So that's typical Heck error functions. So typically write them as z. First one is rho f phi S. This one is z rho f phi twist with eta and s, right? That was the character there. So it's basically a product of two error functions. And then in fact, if your phi come from some automorphic form, so basically this is the error function for your representation. This is the error function representation twist by eta. So when this product together, that's exactly the best change of your GR2 error function from F to E. So that's the reason I want to do that. So okay, so that's a pretty interesting. I introduced one extra eta there. Okay, so so in fact, for us, we want to do something much simple than this thing. Okay. So we introduce the J over D, this analytic kernel, that's already in the kernel there, it's defined to be, you take a derivative D of DS, R to the power, then take S equals 1, that J HD of S. I forget what the HD is, right? HD is a function inside C infinity G of A is a characteristic function of the set of their integral matrices, G inside G of O of A, and the determinant, the divisor of the determinant of G equals D. Okay? So there's something like that. So it's just a characteristic function of the set there. So it's a smooth function. So the main theorem, the proof, the theorem. So this is the main theorem. Like a Gorzaga, we have analytical part, geometrical, but main theorem is that there's a main identity. Is that this I of D, that the geometric kernel I constructed, is basically the intersection pairing between the Drinfeld Hingenden cycle and its translation by HD equals to this number, the log of Q minus R of J of D. Right? And this makes sense because this is a rational number, right? If you take a derivative, each derivative get a log of Q. So you have to take the log of Q R to the power. So that's the identity you can prove. So their example is that the case we care is D equals 0, right? Because that's the thing we care about. When D equals 0, J0, JH0, so just the H0 is a characteristic function of JR2 of O, is essentially, you can calculate precisely, go back to calculate everything. It's not really hard. Q minus 2 plus L eta 2s plus L eta minus 2s. So this will give you G of 0 equals and all the number for L eta 0 plus Q minus 2 is R equals 0 is R to the Q to the R plus 2 L of R eta 0 if R is bigger than 0 even the 0 otherwise. So you can compute everything done. So this give you the high Chola Seibel formula. So if you prove this identity, just take a D equals 0, you're done. But as I said that, you cannot prove this identity for D equals 0. You can only prove this identity when D is big. So that's the interesting part. So actually, even if you want to prove Chola Seibel, you don't care about Gorzaga, you still end up doing Gorzaga anyway. For any D.
Then you prove just for D?
For bigger D. Then using this, there's a pseudo modularity because the V0 is a finite dimensional. Yeah. Okay. So now we want to do something more precise. What we're going to do is, so now assume, so let's see what's going on. Assume. Well,
so will you give an idea about how it's proved? You have an intersection number which is decomposed into a sum.
I will explain. That's my next section. Yeah. So I will talk about spectral decomposition a little bit. So about the spectral decomposition. I'll talk about spectral decomposition. Of this J of D, already done for I of D. Remember, I of D is summation lambda pi of D, you know, times the z pi. So let's try to do this thing. So in this case, why? Right, I mean that this H D, so this F is equal H D is spherical, right? So it's invariant on both sides, and so we can have, so we need only care about this decomposition, G of F, G of A, G of O of A. This actually is a sum. It's just space of spherical forms. Forms has no level at all. So that's pretty easy. This essentially the representations. So this you can write down direct sum. Of course, this direct sum could be infinity direct sum, could be other than zeros inside. We're not bother to do that. So pi is automorphic for P02 and a spheric. Both automorphic spheric. The C time phi of pi. Okay, so modular, maybe plus some Eisenstein part. It's Eisenstein series. So in other words, I'm in there, maybe just forget about this part. I don't want to make it very confusing. So this sum, this integration could be included some integration inside. So there's a phi pi, so a unitary base of pi, but invariant GL, P of G, O of A. Well, this is a one dimensional. It's just a pick of one vector whose L2 norm is one, right? So you have a you have many choice. So the rho f of phi pi is also this lambda pi of f of phi pi. So this is the same thing as the Satake parameter I introduced before. And so this give you the k f x and y will be summation lambda pi of f and phi of x of pi, phi pi bar of y, all this pi here. Yeah, so that's a very interesting, very simple decomposition. So you bring everything in, then this will give you j of fs. So this is a zeta integral introduced at the beginning. In this case, you bring in, you get a very simple decomposition, summation lambda pi of f. And L pi, you best change it to E and S. So that's a very simple thing from everything there. Okay, so I get this decomposition. So in particular, I have, if I take F, H over D, and I take R's derivative, then I get this J of D summation lambda pi of F of L R's derivative of pi E at the center. I'm a bit confusing. My S is normalized the center. I put a 1 here, but be prepared. This I really mean the center. Okay, so I don't know. I lost my normalization of the error function. I don't know half is the center or 1 or whatever, because presumably they're everything I'm doing for center automorphic forms. Okay, so this is great. So we have this identity, but recall that H of D. So recall another identity, I of D, summation lambda pi of H of D of Z of pi, Z of pi, right? I know these two are equal for arbitrary D, right? And the other side, I have many such coefficients. So I can show that for all the D together, this is sufficient to conclude that the bigger theorem, on the main theorem of the Yun and Zhang's work, there's a high growth Zagier formula. I call it high growth Zagier, is that z over pi, maybe equal to, I don't know, some constant I could not write down, so log of q to the r to the power derivative pi e of 1. Okay? As a Christoph's question, what are you concerned in? This already gives you a very interesting phenomenon. So one corollary, of the GRH, because GRH we know for cuspid forms, right? For GR2, because then one corollary of the business is that z over pi is not zero. Z over pi is bigger than zero from the full. Let me try to say. Oh yeah, I'm sorry. So if R is bigger than greater than order of vanishing of L pi E of S, right? S equals 1, then Z over pi is bigger than 0. So in particular, Z over pi is not 0. So that's a very strong consequence, because in algebraic geometry, the one difficulty for us is constructing algebraic cycles. This formula tells you that starts with the first few of them, that's governed by BSC conjecture. Everything else will be positive. So now the big question for us is, how can we use these cycles? Go back to study arithmetic. I think Zhiwei Yun and Wei Zhang, they got some formula, some information about that, the compatibility with the BSD conjecture. So they can show that the class of Z of pi somehow lives in the determinants of Selmer group, because that's a regulator. So that's something they can show, but only in cohomology level. One thing to be really careful that, of course, right, if pi is spherical, they don't have elliptic curve of a spherical here. So only one example we can think about it is probably Shimura curve. When Shimura curve, you take the extension, the family of Shimura curve. If you have a Shimura curve of Q, you must on P. P is not, does not define discriminant. This is a parameter of the family. That family, the error function can be studied by this method, right? And one thing I'm warning you is that this Z of pi is a cycle constructed on the modular stack. We don't know how to make this cycle to be the cycle and your abelian variety or something. So we don't have like in a modular curve case, we have modular curve mapped to elliptic curve. Any points on modular curve will give you a point on elliptic curve. Here, no. It's the relation between the elliptic curve of function field and the modular stack is more complicated. It's not simply say there's a Jacobian map from one to other. So you don't expect to parametrize by your elliptic curve by the modular stack. When R is bigger than 1, or R equals 1, there's something you can do that. When R is bigger than 1, there's no relation. If we assume a Taylor's conjecture, there is a relation, right? If the Taylor conjecture is not proved, we don't know the relation between the cycles and the elliptic curve function field and the stack with R legs. So this is one drawback. Yeah. Okay. So this is so we get a high Gorzaga formula. Okay. So I introduce the algebraic kernel. I introduced the geometric kernel and the analytic kernel, and presumably you want to prove this this theorem. This is the main theorem I'm going to prove, right? But in their paper, they don't really prove these two numbers together directly. So when you do Gorzaga, you prove these two things by computing local intersections, right? You compute them, then find them, same. There's another approach proposed by Wei Zhang called arithmetic fundamental lemma. It's the same thing, you compute intersection numbers. Here, at the very beginning, I give you a hint. You don't compute intersection numbers. You compute intersection in the cohomology. So it means that you have to use some other tool to do that. So the last thing I want to introduce is is some perverse sheaf. So the strategy that prove that formula is by make a connection. So there, so I will introduce some perverse sheaf. Some perverse sheaf. A perverse sheaf. And left sheaf. Trace a left shift number. Okay, so let D. Okay, now you want to study DB effective divisor, and you want a degree of D. It's bigger than max of 4G minus 3 of 2G. So you see now it's already we want D be big. You cannot prove that. So they actually prove this identity. So there, Yun-Zhang, the proved identity, the identity, and this assumption first, and by using Lefschetz. Left shift trace formula. So what I really mean is that they translate both sides as a left shift number of some perverse sheaf of some geometric base.
So it means you have a cohomological correspondence on a certain complex, and does the decomposition correspond to the decomposition into the local factor? It means the local intersections, the fixed part. So you have a cohomological correspondence on a certain, let's say, complex.
Right.
And then you have some Verdi formula, which interpret that in terms of local intersection of a fixed part.
Right.
Is it exactly that, the decomposition?
Right. So are we not going to hold the bigger complex of this thing? So I will write on the last sheaf. Which sheaf used in both sides? So I will write on the sheaf there. So they show that it's both sides a left shift number of one perverse sheaf. So that's what I'm going to show there. And the general construction is very complicated, but the last one is not difficult to explain. So they study something. Let me write down some notation. So like D. Be degree of D. So they introduce a couple of stack. So there's XD. We have XD. We just give some notation. So XD is X to D to the power, a symmetric of D. So this is just the moduli of device degree D. And inside here, you have XD of 0. So this is for device without a multiplicity. So this is just device D, sigma xi, not of xj. You have no multiplicity at all. And this one, you get another bigger one. This is a pairs, it's a stack of pairs, LL. So the degree of L is D. L is a section. Okay, so if L is non-zero, you get this back, right? So here we do not require L is zero or not. So it's just stack. So this one you can write as L equals zero, and L is not equal zero. So it's basically X of D with joined with a pick D of X. Okay, so it's just it's a stack, the union of two stacks. So one's open, one's closed, because L equals zero is the equation. Right? There's a closed stack, there's an open stack. So this is basically the geometrization of the matrix, Heck algebra. Heck algebra has a lot of, it's Heck algebra, each element is a matrix, x11, x12, x21, x21. You take a geometrization of the matrix, right? But each of x11, x12, you can represent by divisor, right? So you represent the divisor by line bundles, right? So this basically, what I'm doing in the blackboard is just geometrization of Heck algebra. Okay, so this is Artin stack. It's not a Dilling-Manifold. Over the dimension is equals d. Dimension g minus one. Because the stack and modulus their correspondence. So then we talk about the covering. So now I write the picture here. So you have xd0 goes to x over d goes to x of d. Then I have y of d, right? Yd0. Let me try and see what I'm going to do. Y of d. Well, I can get everything. Yd hat there, so this morphism yd0. And then here I have y over d and a 0 here, right? I have this morphism. So this means that it copies, I take all the diagonal out, right? So I have this morphism. And this morphism, this is a Galois with a group. The group can be easily write down. You see, first you get, let me see, you get this one to be x of d, right, 0. Then this morphism is by symmetric power, s of d, right? This is a copies, two copies. So this is called mu 2 to the d's power. So the Galois group will be the semi-product. Let me write down called gamma is mu 2 over d semi-product of s of d. Right? So s of d is a symmetric group.
So the central one is well defined from y of d, yd to xd?
It's just a divisor, effective divisor.
But you want that things are without multiplicities.
Central.
Oh, no, the one is without multiplicities. Yeah. So the first one is it? So you.
Oh, I know what you mean. What do you talk about it? Yeah, I will talk. I will know what you talk about.
This one is well defined.
No.
No. It's not well defined.
So this is why you are maybe removing the diagonal. So in fact, the only thing which is well defined is just on the left.
Yeah. This is defined. This is well defined. This is not well defined. You are completely correct. So
just remove the vertical part.
You remove more device, remove pullback of diagonal. Yeah. Okay. So we define this thing by pullback. Remove the diagonals. Image of diagonals. Okay. 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 So then I will define some shift there. So this allow us to define the sum representation. Let me try to stand. So. Okay. So for each I, 0 and a d, then we can construct there's a subgroup, gamma I equals to mu 2 of d, then the still semi product, but a high si, si d minus I. So this, it's everything I'm doing, it's just like the cutting the matrix here. So I just break my letters, copies of a product to I copies, d minus I copies. So I defined a representation chi I, or gamma I to plus or minus 1 by the following one, the chi I of, let me write down here, epsilon 1, epsilon d, sigma I, sigma d minus I to be just the product of I here, just the first I product is a trivial and everything else. So this is the character. So this character is the invariant under this group. This is the character of here. The reason is, you see, so this, you take a product from 1 to I. This is the semi-product here, you will find it will not change anything. Right? So this is a character. So then I went to define a representation. Well, I define a representation again. So I when the error is not equal to P, then I defined inducer representation from this gamma of I. Sorry, this gamma I, my notation is not very good, or the gamma of gamma, okay? And the gamma of this chi I, like the rho I here, you can show this rho I is irreducible. Okay, great. So this gives you a sheaf, right? It gives you a sheaf. Define a local system. So maybe I write down called a ki of 0 on x on d 0. So you get a local system on this open set. Now what do? You extend this sheaf, right? So write a ki to the middle extension of ki 0 on xd. So really mean that, well, j shrink the ki in the notation of Dillon Bernstein, their book is given by this thing. So we're not going to explain so what the metric extension is. It's just extension so that the local cohomology has certain minimal support you can have. So you get this shift there, and now we define the Li. So we define a sheaf. So this is give you a sheaf XD. So finally, so we define on this sheaf to be the direct sum of ij equals 0 to d and d minus 2jr. Okay. So this is just the let me write down. It's just how can I write down this thing? So this may not be positive, right? It's positive. R is a positive number. So I'm okay. So I worry about this thing. So the ki, kj of this thing. So this is on x of d of xd. So it defines this perverse sheaf. So the main theorem they are proving is the following. So that's so far I define everything only d. I have not yet talked about anything depends on the diversity.
It's the sum for e and g from 0 to d.
Yes.
Of d minus 2g.
D minus 2j. Yeah, no I there.
You mean what means you multiply copies, number of copies?
Just rank. Maybe what is you want here? Direct sum? D minus 2j over r. Okay. Just the copies.
What is the relation between I and j? No relation?
No relation.
So if G equal D, what is it? It's minus D?
If
J equal D.
But R is even, yeah.
R is even.
R is even, okay.
Yeah, so it's safe. Yeah. You get this big shift? Okay, so now the interesting thing happened. So now this is the shift constructed in two copies of enlarged devices, enlarged device stack. So the finally, if you, so let D, I mean, go back to our D there, let write A of D to B, I'm sorry, this stupid notation, maybe, how can I write down here? So I mean the affine space. Okay. So this is a very stupid notation. So this means that it's affine space. Now, can I have a affine scheme of FQ with space, with FQ points? Gamma of X, OX of D. Okay, so just to define this, so it's a vector space, I make it affine space. Then this A of D, we are mapped to XD of XD of the base. Oh yeah, this has the pick. I'm sorry, so this is actually of the pick, pick a D of X. We pick D of X. I guess this thing can be mapped to here. Do I need a, yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter. I get this thing. So this is morphism given by, if you have a section of the line bundle, if you have a section of D, of this line bundle, it goes to, so this means that it's a one line bundle with two sections, right? Because each of them is a pair of line bound and a section. Your fiber product of this thing means one line of two sections. So the line bound is OX of D, section is one is L, one is L minus one. Okay, so you just embedding everything to there. Yes, so once you get this in, you can define the finally, so we define the Lefschetz number, Lefschetz kernel or whatever. If you like it to call that, define to be the summation of A of AD of FQ and the trace and the Frobenius of A. Or A bar, right? A L R of A bar, right? So that's the number you get. So the man, so the Yun and the Zhang prove their theorem identity by proving two identities, by two identity. So I of D equals T of D equal to J of D, take a log Q of R. So this is two, I suppose I want to prove. But they cannot prove directly. They prove this one equal this one, this one equal this one. So
L of R is the L you define here.
What?
L of R is just the
error there, yeah. So I use error because I want to record there. Yeah, L of R is, you're right, it's just the local system there. I mean, it's a perverse shift. Okay, so let me try to see what else I want to say. Well, so they What do they prove? You can imagine they for each the two sides they construct two shifts, right? And they now construct two shifts on this XD cross XD. Then they're trying to do these two shifts. Both of them are perverse shift. They are isomorphic over some open part, right? So then by continuity, they must be isomorphic to each other. So at the end, they show everything by show the isomorphy between three shifts. So that's the end of their proof. And for generalization of this proof to high level, you can see clearly the difficulty because it needs that the modular stack is smooth over FQ, right? You have an integral model. Right now, I think they're recently the external result to the case R equal R the order all even and the conductor with square free conductors. So you are Hori level structure, right? When you are Hori level structure, they can do that. And but I presumably this this square free is a crucial condition, right? Because if not square free, we don't know, we don't have any modular interpretation of the modular stack, right? Square free, that's the only thing you can do. You know, like a Shimura curve, for example, in the classical case. When they have a better reduction, and the discriminant, when P is square free, we know what's going on. P not square free, generic fiber we know has a covering, but we don't know how to extend everything to the special fiber. We don't have a modular interpretation, right? I guess, but probably with the Lagrange program, like Weinstein's proof, they can figure out each component what they look like, but they don't know what the multiplicity is. So there's they cannot really construct a semi-stable models of this kind of thing. Okay, so maybe I should stop here.
So I guess your I of D equals T of D is the left shift fixed from
I of D
equal T of D.
Yes.
Should be the left shift fixed point from.
Yeah, other one is also.
Yeah,
because the J of D right on this thing, this is eta, whatever. The eta can be translated to a shift. If you write everything down, right, this so that's why I call it geometrization. Actually, that one's much more clear because the summation of the matrices. The matrices, you can translate this entries of matrices to be the section of a bundle. So you have four bundles there. You can write down this double integration as the sum of some points and of a stack, the trace numbers. And that's the one actually even more clear. If you read their paper, that's probably done in the first few pages.
But for me, sometimes the left shift fixed point formula, so you have some fixed point, which are this A of D of FQ.
Yeah.
These are the fixed point by Frobenius.
Yeah.
So if you write something like this, there should be some local terms. So that should be equal to 1. In some sense, there is some statement that you have to prove. Or either you twist with the Frobenius and use the Linus conjecture,
which is
proved by Fujiwara, or you prove that these local terms are 1. So what you prove exactly in this case? If it's exactly as in...
I think there...
Do they use the Linus conjecture by twisting by a big power of Frobenius, which is proved by Fujiwara?
No, they use the Warshawski's treatments, but not the Delinze conjecture.
But he also approved it. Yeah,
right.
Definitely, he approved it. Okay.
Yeah, they use the Warshawski's result, but they probably not use very serious result of Fujiwara, because I think the reason is in the case they use is a proper. So when the d is bigger,
yeah,
the situations they involve are proper finite type. So they're probably in that case you don't need the Fujiwara results. even the classical, even SGA 4.5 should be enough. That case should be, I mean, the classical case is enough. I think something goes wrong is when it's not a safe, not a proper. That's a cause problem. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.